Hello, one and all. My name is Srio, and welcome back to another Match Day vlog here on my YouTube channel. So, in what feels like an eternity, Chester FC's league campaign finally commences. Later on today, where we do make the journey over to Yorkshire to take on Farsley Celtic away in our opening match of the new season, and also our first away match of the new league campaign, where we do look to get off to a flyer. So our wait to finally play competitive league football again has not only been long due to our more extensive pre-season schedule, which saw us play 11 matches, but due to a COVID-19 outbreak amongst our squad about a week ago, it has been all the more lengthier because we do begin our league campaign 1 week later than most other clubs in our division. I do believe our players did return back to training on Thursday night, so they will not have had much time out on the training pitch to prepare for the big kickoff, which will set us back, but at least everybody has now made a full recovery, including our co-manager Anthony Johnson, who, having severely suffered with COVID, does look to have made a full recovery, which is absolutely superb. So anyway, I am thoroughly looking forward to today because for two reasons. Because to begin with, I have never been to the Citadel before, which is where Farsley do play at, while also, of course, it is our first match of the new season, so I am really excited for our new campaign. So hopefully we will take a bumper away following of, I would reckon, in the region of 500, which I do think would be superb. So hopefully we can roar our boys onto a dream start. So I am so excited now, really looking forward to it. So of course, I do hope you all enjoy my vlog for today. Like usual, if you do, please like, subscribe, and also comment down your thoughts on the game below. So enjoy. Everything will be coming up right now. Come on, your seals. Let's do this. Let's get off to a flyer. Come on, blue boys. Today's encounter with Farsley Celtic will not be a straightforward one to begin with, given our Yorkshire opponents have assembled a really impressive side. So I do expect them to be sniffing around the top half this campaign. Anyway, our last match was two Saturdays ago, where we got beat 3-2 away against Nantwich Town away, where we did end an otherwise encouraging pre-season campaign on a bit of a sour note. Unfortunately, I did have to miss my first game of pre-season due to my well-documented week-long holiday down over in Torquay, so I could not make Nantwich away. Although I do believe the opening half sounded relatively even. On the approach to the half-hour mark, Sean Miller made it 1-0 to Nantwich Town by converting from across. Only 1 minute later though, we responded immediately to make it 1-1 because Anthony Dudley slotted in following lovely work by our assist king, James Hardy. Just a few moments later, Anthony Dudley so nearly turned the game around for us, but sadly his strike struck the post. Even though we did improve as the half progressed, we could only head into the half-time interval on level terms. Meanwhile, I do think the second period seemed to be much more eventful, given plenty of goals were scored for either side, while we also had a penalty really late on too. Towards the 70th minute mark, Sean Miller bagged his second of the game to make it 2-1 to Nantwich Town by stabbing in the rebound following Sean Miller's initial shot, which crashed back off the post. for an Ipswich Town. We managed to respond yet again, though, because Declan Weeks latched onto the end of a delightful James Hardy pass for us to make it 2-2. With less than 10 minutes remaining, Ipswich Town retook the lead for the third time to make it 3-2 because Joel Stair headed in from a free kick. We did have a golden chance to equalise yet again because Jude Oyibo was fouled to award us with a penalty inside the area, but rather disappointingly, Anthony Dudley's penalty for us was saved by Cameron Terry. So in general, not the most ideal way for us to end our pre-season. However, it is what happens from today which will count the most. How many times have you seen the papers abortion the plan? It will take about 2 hours to get to Farsley Celtic from here, so compared to our other away days, which will follow later on in our campaign, I do think it will be a relatively short journey. So I do look forward to today for another particular reason, given I will be able to go back on our supporters coach again called the Hip Kiss Express. So I have really missed going on our coaches to all of the away games because I know a lot of people who do go on there, so I do miss the camaraderie, while I also do miss chatting to everyone on the journey and also on the way home. So although I have enjoyed going to our pre-season away matches by train, I do look forward to going on our coaches again because to begin with, it is so much more cheaper. A £15 return to Farsley today is an absolute bargain, while if I went by train, I would have to pay about £40, so an absolute no-brainer. While on the coach, you know everyone, and also on a train, you don't really know everyone because you travel with strangers unless you do go with your mates, like I do sometimes. So I do really look forward to going on our coach again today. So anyway, to begin with, Farsley Celtic do play at the Citadel, which holds 3,900. So I do look forward to going there later on today, given I have never been to the Citadel before. So I do look forward to going to yet another new ground. So all in all, I do think it is, to be honest, a poor ground for our league, given most of it is open to the elements, and also I do think it is a really poor ground because you don't have a lot of cover either to make an atmosphere, and also looking at a few photos, I do think it will be a tough pitch to play on today. So compared to a lot of other grounds in our league, I certainly do think the Citadel is up there with one of the worst. I do think Latimer Park, home of Kettering Town, is probably the worst, but I do think Farsley, the Citadel, does follow it rather closely. So anyway, to begin with, on one side you do have the main stand, which is a covered seated stand going for about one quarter of the pitch towards the shed end, while you do have some supporting pillars which will hinder your view. To the left of it, towards the shed end, once again, you do have an uncovered terrace, which makes up another quarter of the pitch, while to the right of the seated stand, making up half of the pitch, you do have another uncovered terrace, which goes towards the east end. Meanwhile, opposite the main stand, you do have the north terrace, which is another uncovered terrace. However, this time it does go for the entire length of the pitch, thus reinforcing why I do think the Citadel is a really bad ground. Meanwhile, behind one goal, you do have the shed end, which is a covered terrace, going for the whole length of the pitch, and I do think, to be fair, it is probably the best stand in the entire ground, given you can make a decent atmosphere. However, there are a whole array of supporting pillars which will obstruct your view, and also if today's game is segregated right in the middle of the terrace, a little bit similar to the away end at Kidderminster Harriers. You do have two segregation fences to separate the home supporters from the away supporters. And last to lay behind the other goal, you do have the east end, which is an uncovered, open flat standing area open to the elements. So if today's game is segregated, because you never know, there could be a slight chance given we will take a really good away following, because then we will be allocated half of the north terrace, a small section of the main stand, and also the entirety of the north terrace. So anyway, I really cannot wait. Now hopefully we will take a huge away following, and hopefully it will also be a top away day out. Farsley Celtic have assembled a fairly good side, together with the Yorkshire outfit looking to break into the top half this campaign. Since their promotion back in 2019, the Celt Army are still yet to complete a full campaign here in the Vanarama National League North, although they have still fared really well on the whole to defy the odds, given many people year upon year do write them off. Last campaign was unfortunately halted really early on due to COVID-19, but even though a limited amount of fixtures were fulfilled, Farsley was still sat in a respectable 11th place position at the time of the campaign being ended really early on, so they are certainly no pushovers. We will also be up against one former seal at the Citadel later on today, who is right winger Ben McKenna. Ben joined us from fellow Yorkshire side Bradford Park Avenue AFC in January 2019, where I did think on the whole he was a handy player for us, thus I did want us to retain him. However, he was disappointingly released from us in May 2019. McKenna joined Farsley Celtic from fellow National North side Spennymoor Town in June of this year and has been there ever since, so he will look to be one of the Celt Army's key outlets this campaign. And although I do have a lot of time for Ben personally, because I only met up with him about a month ago, as recently as a month ago, where we did beat Clitheroe 1-0 away in pre-season, where I did have a good chat with him. So although I do like him a lot as a person, I still hope he and also his Farsley teammates will be on the losing side come 5 o'clock tonight. Meanwhile, here is our head-to-head record against Farsley Celtic. So, in general, we have played 2, won 1, drew 1, and also lost 0. So, we do have a really good record over Farsley, given we are unbeaten, while we also do have the upper hand over the Celt Army. So, hopefully we can maintain that later on today, while our most recent meeting was a 2-2 away draw in the Vanarama National League North at the Citadel on Tuesday, November the 24th, 2020. So given the whole of last season, we were unable to go to any games for a couple near Christmas. I was unable to go to that one over in Yorkshire, so I was really gutted given it was a 4-goal thriller. I was always told everybody should get the same. My score prediction for today's encounter is Farsley Celtic 1, Chester FC 2. So I do think the solitary scorer for the Celt Army will be the experienced season pro James Hansen, while I think our two scorers will be Darren Stevenson and also
James Hardy.
So I do think it will be a tight affair today, given, like I alluded to, I do think Farsley will have another good season, while, like I also mentioned, I do think the actual pitch will be really difficult to play on. However, that is no fault of Farsley, because we have to adapt to it, and if we do fail to win today, then we would only have ourselves to blame for. So even though I do think the pitch may not be ideal, we do have to adapt to it, because it has been our Achilles heel under our Burn and Jono tenure thus far, where we have really struggled to play on poorer pitches, which is no fault of the teams, because I do not expect every single pitch in our league to look like Wembley. So we do have to adapt to it, otherwise I do think it could be our focal point. So I do think it will be your typical early season tight, scrappy, cagey affair. However, I do think we will emerge as the winners for today. How many times have you been told? You don't ask either. Like I mentioned literally moments ago, one thing which has always been our Achilles heel under Burn and Jono thus far is our inability to adapt to poorer pitches properly, and with the surface at the Citadel not in the greatest of conditions historically, it is vital we do adapt to it, and also it is also crucial we do learn from those lessons this season, because that is the difference from promotion and also staying down here for yet another campaign. However, regardless, I am really excited for this one, given I have never been to the Citadel before, while it is also the beginning of a brand new campaign, so I really cannot wait now. And also, like I mentioned, I do hope we will take a bumper away following today, so hopefully we can make an atmosphere to remember to roar our lads onto a dream start to our new league season. So anyway, my match vlog will be coming up right now, stay tuned. And also, before I do get into it, my vlogs are going to change for this season a little bit, because obviously I am unable to record league matches due to the ongoing copyright embargo. However, I am also not going to record my face from now on, because I do want to live in the real moment again. So what I will do is I will continue to record the atmosphere, because I do really enjoy not only being a part of the atmosphere, but I also like to record and also take it in to show other people what our support can be like. So I will continue to record our atmosphere and also one or two other things throughout the match. However, I will not show my face from now on, because like I said, I do want to live in the real moment again. I want to enjoy the match a lot more than I used to, because I want to celebrate a lot more, you know, things like that, really. So basically, I will only record my face to give half-time and also full-time updates. However, I will never, from now on, record it throughout the game, because another thing I am aiming to do is to also cut down on the actual duration of my videos, because a lot of my recent vlogs have been 40 or even 50 minutes, which is ridiculously long. So hopefully I can get my vlogs maybe near the 30 minute mark again. So I do hope you, regardless, continue to watch and also enjoy my videos. I am sure you will. So anyway, my vlog will be coming up right now. Stay tuned, please subscribe, like, and also comment down your thoughts on the encounter below. So come on, your seals, I really cannot wait. Now let's get off to a start to remember. Come on, boys, we are all right behind you. Come on, City. How many lies have taken your money? Your mother said you shouldn't bet. Lies and fun. Is it always a man with a gun? Someone must have told him if you work too hard, you can sweat. Oh, I have now arrived here at the Citadel, ready for our opening encounter of the new season. So, my journey from Chester all the way to Farsley went relatively well, although it did take us a little bit more longer than originally anticipated due to a lot of traffic going into Yorkshire. However, we are now here about an hour before kickoff, which is decent enough. So, even though I did criticise Farsley's pitch prior to today's game, and also the Farsley Celtic Twitter admin did, respond to me rather unprofessionally, I do have to say, I do believe the pitch is really good today, having looked at it first. And so fair play to Farsley. Therefore, I do think if we do not get off to the start we would like to ideally get off to today, then we must not blame the pitch, because in my opinion, I do think the pitch is superb. It is really short. The actual patterns are really good too. So yeah, like I say, fair play to Farsley. So it will be a relatively difficult beginning to the new season today, because like I alluded to, Farsley do have a good team for this season, so I do think it will be a tough start. However, it was really good to travel here on our coach again, with so many familiar faces, talking to so many people again, so the camaraderie was really good. So hopefully we will take a bumper following to today's game to hopefully draw us on to a valuable 3 points to begin our new season. So the weather here is absolutely terrible, because before it was torrential rain. However, it isn't too bad now, it has dried up a little bit, so hopefully it will be like this for the entirety of the game, which won't be too bad. However, we absolutely do need to get a win today, so hopefully we will get off to a flyer. Come on, City, let's do this. Here's your Farsley Celtic squad for today's match, and here's your Chester FC squad for today's encounter. We are in a 4-4-2 formation, so to begin with, in goal is number 1 Louis Gray, in defence is 20 Jamie Morgan, 5 Danny Livesey, 3 Simon Grand and 6 Dan Cowan. In midfield is 7 James Hardy, 8 captain George Glendon, 4 Declan Weeks and also 27 John Johnston, and up front is 11 Darren Stevenson and also 9 George Waring. on our substitutes benches. 12, Luke Clark. 17, Jude Oyibo. 18, Matty Williams. 19, Lloyd Marshews. And 23, Josh Askew. Enjoy the vlog. Come on, City.
How we get there, I don't know. How we get there, I don't care. All I know is Chester's on their way. Run away! Run away! To the National League! Run away! How we get there, I don't know. How we get there, I don't care. All I know is Chester's on their way. Run away! Run away! To the National League! Run away!
Jim Alfelt, son, and get your father's gun. And shoot the Rex and scum, shoot the Rex and scum, sheep suckers.
No, no, can you hear the falsy sing? I can't hear a fucking thing. Oh, shh. We're Chester FC, we're on our way back. Can't hear the falsy sing, we'll sing on our own. Sing on our own. Sink an arrow. We're Chester FC. We're on our way back. Come on, City! Come on, City!
Half time, Farsley Celtic 2, Chester FC 1. So, I do think in general, not the ideal start to our season we did want, because I have been saying to a few people, we have been in pre-season mode for the majority of the half, because we have been absolutely atrocious. Because I do know the pitch here isn't the best. However, I still think it is quite a good surface. Therefore, I think we definitely do need to begin to play the ball on the floor a lot more, because throughout the entirety of the half, we have just kicked the ball to wherever really, which has not helped us at all. So I do think in general, an absolutely abysmal half, because Farsley Celtic went into a 2-0 lead. So to begin with, a cross came in and their player finished into the bottom corner. So awful defending, while for their second goal, a similar goal really, because another cross went in and a Farsley Celtic player headed home to make it 2-0. So a really embarrassing half all in all. However, you do have to give a lot of credit to Farsley, because they have been by far the better team. However, as the half went on, we did begin to come into the game a lot more, because in the final 10 minutes we did create a lot more chances, and thankfully that did pay dividends, because George Waring headed home to make it 2-1, so he did get on the end of a lovely ball to head home to put us back into the encounter. So not enough really, because
right.
not enough really, because we have to be winning today. Every single match is now a must win. However, now we are back into the game. Hopefully it will give us a lot of momentum going into the second half, and hopefully Bern and Jono will give our players hairdryer treatment at half time, because we need to be so much more better. So anyway, hopefully onwards and upwards, because on a side note, our atmosphere so far has been absolutely superb. Yeah, because we have took a really good turnout today, so hopefully our supporters, myself included, will be rewarded with a much more better second half. Come on, you Seals. Time for Arsley Celtic 2 Chester FC 2. So I have now arrived back here in Chester, so I do think all in all a really good away day, because we took a superb following of well over 500, I do believe, by a few supporters. So I do think, given at half time or before half time we were 2-0 down, I do think in the end 2-all isn't the end of the world. So I do think a relatively decent start to the season. However, hopefully we can get our first win of the new season in a few days' time, where we do play Curzon Ashton at home. So all in all, a really good away day, but hopefully we can all get to the win we do need on Tuesday. So anyway, more reaction shortly. A good away day out, plenty to build on. Celtic 2 Chester FC 2. So certainly not a match for the faint-hearted because my emotions were like a roller coaster early on today, because from fuming at us at half time to feeling elated after we came from two goals down to draw 2-2, it was a true definition of a game of two halves. Given we were so poor in the opening half, a draw is a decent start for us, so even though we did have some great chances to win the encounter really late on, we will just have to take the point and move on, because obviously there is nothing we can do about it right now. It is clear Byrne and Jono gave our lads a rocket at half time, so kudos to them for fighting back, although we cannot afford to play like we did in the opening half and take things for granted once again, because it could prove to be costly as our campaign does progress. Firstly, Celtic were quite a good side, in all fairness, given they pressed us really high up the pitch in their dominant opening half showing, although in the second half it was the complete polar opposite, given the Celt army were less prominent in our penalty area. Our showing in the first half was shocking, because we were still in pre-season mode by being happy to soak up Farsley Celtic's pressure while we had no direction or ambition at all. Defensively, we were all over the shop, because we did not know what to do when attempting to clear or head the ball away, and given the pitch was much better than originally anticipated, we failed to capitalise on that by just hoofing the ball away rather than attempting to play it on the deck. Credit does have to go to Farsley, given they were by far better than us, but another frustration is that due to us sitting so far deep, whenever we did have a presence at the other end, there was absolutely nobody there to help out poor George Waring or Darren Stevenson out, who did have to do all of the hard work all on their own. It only took 5 minutes for Farsley Celtic to take the lead, given Tyler Walton fired across the face of goal into the far corner in what was a bad goal to concede, given he did have acres of space on the right hand side. Our first chance came courtesy of John Johnston, who despite slipping still managed to force a good save out of Tom Donaghy, while at the other end a Luke Parkin header was straight at our own goalie Louis Gray. Things got from bad to worse towards the half hour mark for us, because Adam Clayton made it 2-0 to Farsley Celtic by simply nodding in from a corner thanks to our own non-existent defence. After the half-hour mark, though, we did begin to come back into the encounter a lot more, because we were much more lively at our end with George Glendon firing over to begin with. Then, at the other end, Jimmy Spencer forced Gray to turn his attempt behind for the home side. However, with only a few moments to go before the half-time interval, George Waring handed us a lifeline to make it 2-1, because the big man headed in a George Glendon cross to put us well and truly back into the contest. So all in all, after a nightmarish start, we did have something to shout about going into a crucial half-time synopsis. However, the second period was so much more better from us, given we dominated large parts of it by creating plenty of opportunities, while we were much more confident and also dominant in our play. It is just a shame that despite our constant dominance and also pressure, we could not find a winner, although that is credit to Farsley Celtic, because they were composed defensively to make it tough for us to score again. Towards the hour mark, Darren Stevenson blasted over after Declan Weeks played him through, before Dazzler had another chance soon after, where he fired straight at Tom Donaghy, while at the other end, Louis Gray made a remarkable save to palm a Will Hayhurst hit over. Only 1 minute later, we eventually managed to grab an equaliser as George Waring secured his brace by heading home an inch-perfect Dan Cowan delivery for us to make it to all. Lloyd Marshuis was inches away from winning the game for us, but sadly he could not capitalise on a terrible back pass to Farsley's custodian by dragging wide. Marshuis had another great chance as we entered the final 10, but his fizzing strike towards the near post was kept out by Donaghy. As we entered the 90th minute mark, a tame Jamie Morgan header was denied by the Farsley keeper following Waring's initial scuffed shot. With a whopping 11 minutes of injury time added on, we continued to throw everything at the home side, with a deflected Jude Oyibo effort falling at the wrong side of the post, before Declan Weeks launched a fierce hit towards goal, which went just wide. Even though we constantly piled the pressure on the home side, we couldn't find a winner, but given we were 2-0 down, a point isn't at all a bad start. So, all in all, a mixed bag performance-wise, because some of our players fared much more better than others, mainly our defence. However, my man of the match has to go to George Waring, who saved our day, because if it wasn't for GWAS, we wouldn't have got a single thing early on today. So huge credit to him for using his aerial prowess to head home two really well taken goals. Also, Declan Weeks and even George Glendon were great in the middle, because they overcame a difficult opening half to be our main cogs in the second 45 by being the glue to thread balls through to ensure we did have plenty of openings. Josh Askew was promising when he came on, as was Jude Oyibo, who was really exciting going forward, so in that respect he does have a strong case to start on Tuesday night, where we do entertain Curzon Ashton. Darren Stevenson's work rate was excellent, and I did feel sorry for him in the opening half, given he was doing all of the hard work all on his own with little support out on the right. However, I do think in the second 45 he was rather poor, given his end product just wasn't there. John Johnston wasn't great either, however, I do think it is unfair to slate him at this early stage, because given our squad are still recovering from COVID, while they had only one training session to prepare for today, I do think, personally, I do prefer to give us 10 games to really settle in before I do make true opinions on players. Defensively, we were awful in the opening half, with Simon Grand surprisingly having a bad game, because he was beaten to a lot of balls by Farsley Celtic, but hopefully that will just be a one-off. Our next match is on Tuesday night, where we play Curzon Ashton at home, where we do look to secure our first win of the campaign. So I do think it is vital we do get to that first win on the board sooner rather than later. Therefore, it is really important we do play our part as the 12th man to ensure we do roll us on to victory. I will obviously be off to Curzon Ashton at home on Tuesday night, so look out for a match preview and also a match day vlog, which will be out really shortly. So, all in all, a really enjoyable away day out on the whole, because we took a brilliant following of over 500 who did deserve to witness a win. However, it is critical we do keep backing our lads now, because our support will play a vital role this campaign. I do think the atmosphere we created was quite good too, which is another thing we do have to maintain from Tuesday night, because I fully believe a bouncing diva really can make the difference. It was just great to have that proper away day feeling again, because from travelling back on the hip kiss again to chatting to so many familiar faces at the ground felt like the good old days again, so it is really refreshing to have normal life back. So of course I do hope you all enjoyed my match of the day vlog for today. A few new things trailed out and I do hope you really enjoyed it. If you do, like always, please like, subscribe and also comment down your thoughts on the encounter below. So anyway, see you all in a few days where we do play Curzon at home. Hopefully we can get to that first win. So anyway, keep the faith, come on you Seals, a decent beginning today. Hopefully we can follow it up, come on you Blue Boys.